Sex is one of our primary biological urges. We engage in it for procreation and pleasure.
But recent technological advances are changing the way we have sex.
From test tube babies to gene editing, it is becoming possible to have children artificially who will be healthier than those conceived naturally.
We are almost going against nature. So I'm not sure whether we're de-evolution or whether we're beating evolution.
The rise of pornography, coupled with increased social media usage, has already seen less physical interaction among younger generations, creating a barrier between the real world and the virtual space they are entangled with.
I didn't want to feel the insecurity. I didn't want to feel the loneliness. I didn't want to feel the rejection that I often felt every day. And so if I just masturbated or if I watched porn, then all I had to feel was the pleasure between my legs.
And for those looking for a more physical sexual gratification, robots are being increasingly developed to satisfy sexual fantasies, as opposed to a real-life partner.
You don't know if you're dealing with a human being or whether you're dealing with a technological response of artificial intelligence.
With all these changes to our society, will we stop having sex as we know it?
People have always been inventing and creating different ways to get pleasure.
For millions of years, our ancestors reproduced the same way. A man deposited sperm into a woman in order to fertilize an egg and conceive a child.
That's not the case anymore. In today's society, women can choose to have a baby without having sex.
40 years ago, Louise Brown made headlines around the world when she became the world's first test tube baby. In vitro fertilization, or IVF, was a revolutionary new procedure that allowed a woman to become pregnant when natural conception was either unsuccessful or not possible. By the end of this century, around 157 million people will owe their lives to assisted reproductive technologies like IVF, donor eggs, and surrogacy. Denmark has the highest proportion of babies born this way in the world, with an estimated 10% of children in the country conceived using these technologies. In 2017, the European nation passed a law granting access to state-funded IVF, regardless of a woman's marital status or sexuality. Pia Krohn Christensen is the mother of two-year-old Sarah. She is one of a growing number of solomor, Danish single women who decide to have a child by themselves using donor sperm.
So I've always wanted to have children, and I always thought it was just a matter of time. And I always, like, you know, being younger, like thinking about, like wondering how my husband would, like what kind of person he would be or who he would be, what kind of house we would live in, and how our lives would be. I was 39 and a half, and I hadn't found I don't know if you should call it suitable partner, but I was single. And then I knew it was a possibility to go with the donor, and then went for it, and I was very lucky to become pregnant in my first round of IVF. I went for a blood test, and then I had to go for the blood test in the morning, and then had to call the clinic, and then they told me that I was pregnant, and I was just beyond belief. Like, I was like, really, really, I'm pregnant? And they were like, you sound like you didn't expect it. I was like, I totally didn't expect it. I didn't think it would happen. I didn't think I could be that lucky.
And there are even more exciting possibilities for IVF ahead. Professor Joyce Harper at University College London works to identify embryos at risk of disease, a practice that is becoming both quicker and more affordable.
So what's come into the science arena now is genome sequencing. So sequencing the genome is actually relatively quite straightforward. What everyone's working on now is interpreting that information. It's only really been recent years that we've had the full genetic code of people that we can now examine. So it's a really exciting time, because what does it all mean? If we can check if it's going to get cancer or predisposed to heart disease or diabetes or allergies maybe, then we could do all those tests before we even put the embryo back in the woman. Because why would you transfer an embryo back to a woman that is going to get a disease? So I do wonder, we have to really think carefully about how this future is going to look. Are we going to have a time where actually, even cost-effective wise, it's cheaper for everyone, or almost everyone, to reproduce by this technology so that then we have a much healthier population. So it could happen. It could happen in the next 10 years, maybe.
But it's not just how we procreate that is rapidly changing. People are seeking sexual pleasure in a radically different way than before. The internet age has given rise to free, easily accessible online pornography.
The online porn industry is worth around $15 billion and is reaching more young people every year. 64 million people visited Pornhub on a daily basis in 2016. The following year, it was 81 million. And it's millennials who account for 60% of Pornhub's visitors.
For some, the prevalence of online pornography is creating a new type of addiction.
I was 12 years old when I masturbated for the first time. I found it thrilling, but I was also very scared because I had never heard anybody talk about masturbation. I'd never heard anybody talk about sex, really. So it seemed to be this big mystery that I'd stumbled upon, but I knew that I liked it. I grew up in a really Catholic household, Latino. Nobody ever talked about sex. And the same thing was at school. You know, they made it very clear that sex was something that happened between two married people who loved each other for one reason alone, procreation. And so, but like I said, I wanted to keep doing it. And not long after I made that discovery of masturbation, I stumbled across pornography, softcore porn on cable TV. And I had the same sort of reaction. It was something that was thrilling and exciting and I enjoyed it. But also I felt like it was something I probably shouldn't be doing because nobody was talking about it. So early on, this feeling of pleasure and excitement was wrapped up with this feeling of shame and feeling like I may be doing something wrong. And I couldn't have known then while I was making these discoveries that the internet was becoming more and more sophisticated. I would just have, you know, new chat rooms to look at. I would have the ability to download pictures, and then suddenly pictures were downloading faster, and then I could have streaming clips. And so it all became more enticing and engaging and harder to pull away from.
The anonymity, accessibility, and affordability of online porn is damaging men and women's health more than ever before.
My sexual habits were keeping me from being intimate with other people. Sex was the most important thing, and it started to feel like a mechanical movement. Like I wasn't really deriving much pleasure from it beyond just the attaining an orgasm.
I don't think you can control it. I think it's out there. I think young people spend most of their lives online, and I think pornography is part of that. For some people, when they start viewing things online, for some people, there can not only be the compulsive element in that, you know, they want to constantly be viewing and masturbating to what they're seeing online. I think there can also be an escalation in what they view. They need more and more exciting or different or novel material in order to get the same level of sexual arousal. Because once you've got no boundaries, where do you go? If there are no limits, how far do you go?
And the nature of porn itself is also changing. Virtual reality is creating new immersive experiences to indulge every sexual fantasy imaginable.
In the 90s, Professor Trudy Barber created the world's first immersive sex environment in virtual reality.
Initially, I gamified the sexual space by having condoms flying around, and you could pick up a condom and put it on one of the first virtual stiffies that we made in virtual space. And it just made people think slightly differently. The condom was huge. It was like the size of a Trident missile, and you could fly around with it and stuff in these alternative spaces.
It's like having sex with yourself within yourself. It's quite fascinating, really, because it opens so many doors and so many ideas, but they're really quite creepy because you could be thinking about the end of procreation as we know it, really.
I think it took quite a long time to get access to VR worlds as we know them today because, plain and simple, the cost and the design. When I first started using virtual reality in the early 90s, you're talking about £500,000 for the kit. And the headset was massive. I mean, it was huge. It was like putting a small cathedral on your head. It really was huge. And people were worried about looking stupid in it. And also the lag, the visual lag, it was really bad. And people would feel sick. But it was, you could see the potential in there.
With VR technology rapidly improving, we could soon be able to live out any sexual fantasy we desire without ever having to leave the comfort of our homes.
Well, the amazing thing about sexual space now and the idea of digital spaces is that you've got notions of gender fluidity. You've got different representations of the self in virtual spaces. So you could be anybody or anything that you want to be. So the idea of actually engaging in this space as an alternative self becomes really exciting. And of course, when some people get together with, you know, the person that they want to have sex with, sometimes they engage in fantasy play. They may dress up as somebody, they may, you know, do all these kind of fun things. And you could do exactly the same thing in virtual spaces. People are going to put on these different fabulous avatars of themselves. And I think it's a marvelous time for people to just be something different if they want to be.
It's not just the virtual world that is providing an alternative to sex. For those still seeking physical gratification, sex robots are becoming both more advanced and more affordable. One such robot is Emma. Created by Sex Doll Place, Emma has lifelike robotic features and can hold both sexual and non-sexual conversations.
She's the first artificial sex doll robot that connects to the internet over Wi-Fi and can query information from the internet. So for example, you can ask Emma what the weather is and she'll be able to get that information and tell you. Emma also has a 100% safe electrical heating system, and this makes all the difference in the world to make a doll feel more lifelike.
Do you like s'more dogs?
Yes. I like them very much, they are so cute.
What do you often do in your free time?
I am a teacher, I teach English.
More people are definitely buying sex dolls in general. They've gotten more lifelike and specifically are now interested in the robot sex dolls and the technology that goes along with that to make the doll more lifelike. So currently we're able to sell Emma, our sex doll robot, for under $4,000. Comparing that to other dolls that are typically $10,000 or higher, our price point is sometimes a little bit of a, can be a little bit of a problem because some people don't even believe we can sell, make and sell a high quality sex doll for the price. But we can, and we have sold hundreds around the world.
And it's not just single men that are driving the demand for sex robots.
Many of our customers are actually married men. Often the sexual drive of married couples does not align. So by having the option of having sex with a doll, it satisfies their needs. So that works for many, but everyone is different. So it depends on how they look at bringing a doll into their relationship.
From how we have children to how we indulge our sexual fantasies, technology is increasingly invading every aspect of our lives. As these advances continue, could it eventually lead to a point where the human race dispenses with having sex altogether?
I've often talked about reproduction without sex, and people have been very worried when I've said this, that I'm suggesting people don't have sex. Absolutely, we should all have lots of sex. But I do think that there may be a time when the majority of people are not having sex to reproduce. So these two will become totally separate. And there may be a time when women don't even carry babies. So sex will just be for fun.
For a lot of human beings, there is still a desire for a connection, an emotional connection. And I think that's important. There is still that desire to connect, have a relationship, do things together. That is still, even though our sex drive as human beings is strong, I also think our desire to feel connected, our desire to have a relationship is also strong.
I really don't think there's going to be a big change. I think our sex lives will basically be the same in 50 years as it is today, with most people still needing and having relationships with other humans versus robots or versus sex dolls. I don't think that's ever going to change for society in general. For many people, sex robots will fulfill a real need. And they will be able to do it much better in 50 years as the technology advances even further.
In the future, I don't think we're going to have sex robots per se. What we're going to have is a melding of the biological self with the technological self. The idea of the robot or the sex doll will depend on whether you're with someone who is, say, 40% technology, 60% flesh. We are already becoming the cyborg. The idea of a sex robot and the robot per se is just phase in our continuous development.